very much for the introduction. Thank you all for coming and for giving me the opportunity to tell you a little about my research. I guess any friend of the Institute is a friend of mine, so it's really good to see all of you. So indeed today I'm going to talk about how to test string theory. And just so you have an idea of where I'm going to go in this talk, I'd like to give a little outline. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce string theory. By the way, can everyone see this? So first I'm going to introduce string theory. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about the string landscape in the swampland. And I will define those terms when I get there. And this is going to lead me into something called the weak gravity conjecture. So let's start with string theory. So string theory is a very famous and rather controversial field of physics. It's something that has really captured the imagination even of the public at large. Probably the main reason for this is that string theory makes a number of bizarre postulates about the world that we live in. So one thing it says, that everything that we see is made of strings. So all the things that we used to think were particles, everything that makes up everything in this room is made of strings. String theory also says that the universe is not three-dimensional, which is what we're accustomed to thinking, but rather it's nine-dimensional. So there are sort of six other dimensions that are hidden, and how you should picture these other six dimensions is that they're curled up. They're very small. So as an example, I have this stick here. I was kind of hoping there would be a bigger stick, but this is what I have. So from far away, this little stick looks like it's one-dimensional, right? It just has a length. But if you were to zoom in, if you were an ant living on the surface, you'd find that it actually has a second dimension, because you can not only walk along the length of the stick, but you can also wind around the circumference. So there's this sort of second hidden dimension of the stick that you can't see from the back row, but which I can see from up close. And that's how you should think about these other six dimensions. Is there are these three long dimensions, which are like the length of the stick, and then there are six hidden dimensions that are curled up so tiny that we can't see them. So these are, I think, the things that are sort of the most mind-blowing aspects of string theory, and that's what's really made it so interesting for so many people. But within the string theory community, the reason why we are interested in string theory, the reason we study it, isn't because of these bizarre postulates, but rather because of what it means for the way that we think about physics as a whole. So let me explain that in more detail. And to really understand this, we need to go back to the beginning of the 20th century, to the work of Albert Einstein. So Einstein was famous for his work in two areas of physics. The first one is quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics is the physics of very small things. So things like atoms, electrons, and other subatomic particles. If you want to understand how these things behave, how they move, how they interact with each other, you need to understand quantum mechanics. This is what actually won Einstein his Nobel Prize, is his work on quantum mechanics. But it's not the thing that Einstein is most famous for. And it's not the thing that elevated him to celebrity status. What Einstein really became known for is his theory of general relativity. Which is just a fancy name for Einstein's theory of gravity. And in the theory of gravity, general relativity works well for describing things that are very heavy. So things like planets, galaxies, black holes, even the entire universe considered as a whole. To understand the physics of these objects, you need to understand general relativity. So each of these theories is remarkably well tested. Each of them works phenomenally for describing small things and heavy things, respectively. But you could ask, what about things that are both small and heavy? So things that are sort of in the overlapping domain of validity between quantum mechanics and general relativity. And what you find is when you try to write down the equations that describe these things, which are both small and heavy, is that you get nonsense. You compute things like infinite probabilities. And what that's telling you is that neither quantum mechanics nor general relativity are the whole story. They're incompatible with each other, which means you need something new. And this is not a new situation that we find ourselves in here in physics. This is something that's been happening for centuries. There's an incompatibility between Newton's laws and Maxwell's equations of electromagnetism. And reconciling those two was what led Einstein to his special theory of relativity. But special relativity is incompatible with gravity. And reconciling those two is what led Einstein to general relativity in the first place. So we find ourselves in this familiar situation where we have these two theories, which both work phenomenally in their own domains of validity, but they don't work well together. So we need something new. And this is where string theory comes in. And this is really string theory's claim to fame. String theory is the only mathematically consistent theory that we know of that successfully reconciles quantum mechanics and general relativity. For this reason, we call string theory a theory of quantum gravity, because it's quantum mechanical, and it also has Einstein's theory of gravity. And again, string theory's main claim to fame, the main thing to remember about string theory, is that it is the only mathematically consistent theory of quantum gravity that we have found so far. So from a mathematical, theoretical perspective, string theory is fantastic. You know, we love string theory. But string theory is also very controversial, and for good reason. Because although it has an enormous theoretical framework behind it, it's extremely elegant from a mathematical perspective. It does not have any sort of direct experimental evidence. And the reason for this, to understand why this is, we need to understand this modern paradigm in physics of scale separation. So namely, physics at different energy scales is different. So what do I mean by this? Well, let's think about physics at very low energies. So physics of things that we deal with on a daily basis. So it may be cars or skyscrapers. You know, if you want to build either of these things, you need to know a lot about physics. But the physics that you need to know is really just Newtonian physics. The sort of physics that's been known for centuries. The sort of physics that a high school physics student learns about in their first year. But now let's say that we go up and consider more energetic things. So let's consider some particles that we've sped up and we collide them. So some protons or electrons or something like this. And this is what we do, say, at the Large Hadron Collider. So the LHC, or Large Hadron Collider, is a particle accelerator in Switzerland. And what it does is it takes protons and it speeds them up really fast and it collides them into each other. And these protons have far more energy than, say, cars do when they collide. So to understand how a car collision works, you just need Newtonian physics. But to understand how a particle collision works with a Large Hadron Collider, now you need quantum mechanics. So another way to say this is that in order to test Newton's laws, you can collide some cars together. In order to test quantum mechanics, you can collide some of these particles together. But now let's say we want to test string theory. What we need now is a far more powerful particle accelerator. And you can ask, how much more powerful does it need to be than, say, our very best particle accelerator today, which is Large Hadron Collider? And the answer is that the energies required to test string theory are about 15 orders of magnitude larger than what we can actually build. So it's a factor of 10 to the 15. Now, this is an enormous gap. This figure is certainly not drawn to scale, right? Not only do we not have the technology available to get to string theory, but this is something that is not going to be available in my lifetime, or in my children's lifetime, or probably in my great-great-great-grandchildren's lifetime. Like, this is an enormous technological gap between what we can actually build on Earth and what we need to build in order to test string theory by colliding some energetic objects. A way to think of this is that you can imagine a particle accelerator is sort of like a microscope. And the Large Hadron Collider is the most powerful microscope that we have. But we need a microscope which is about 15 orders of magnitude more powerful. And this is what makes string theory so difficult to test experimentally. Now, there's an idea, nonetheless, that might give you some hope for how you might be able to test string theory, which is, let's suppose that string theory, even though it deals with physics at this very high energy, perhaps it could make some sort of prediction for physics down here at these lower energies that we could actually test with an experiment, say with a Large Hadron Collider or something else. This is what we'd really like. What we'd really like to do is to be able to extract some prediction about low-energy physics, starting from this high-energy theory of string theory. But even this is an enormously difficult problem. And to understand why this is, we're going to be led now into the string landscape. So the issue is that string theory, this theory up here at very high energies, doesn't seem to give rise to unique predictions for physics down here at low energies. So in our universe, say, we know of these four forces. There's gravity, there's electromagnetism, there's a strong force, and a weak force. And what you'd hope is that string theory would predict a universe like that, a universe that has these exact forces. But it turns out that string theory doesn't give rise to a unique sort of possible universe. It doesn't necessarily give rise to a universe like ours. Rather, it gives rise to an enormous collection of possible universes, which have different physics at low energies. So some of these universes have different forces. They might have more than four forces. They might have less than four forces. Some of them, the strength of these forces are going to be different. Some of these universes are going to have different collections of particles. So instead of electrons and protons and neutrons, they're going to have entirely different particles, entirely different chemistry and biology, they would look, just look very different than the world that we live in. Now, exactly how many universes, how many possible universes are consistent with string theory is still an open problem, but the number that's most famously given for the number of these possible universes is 10 to the 500. And even this is probably quite conservative. This collection of all these possible universes is what's known as the string landscape. So the landscape is the set of all of these universes. We say that there are something like 10 to the 500 possible universes in the string landscape. And this leads to a real problem when it comes to trying to test string theory. Because how does science normally work? Right? You have some theory, it makes some prediction, and then you go out and you come up with some experiment to put that prediction to the test. But what we're finding here is that string theory is not giving us unique predictions. It's not predicting a single set of physics. It's not predicting a single universe. It's predicting an enormous set. And sort of the worst case scenario that you can imagine is where any conceivable universe that's mathematically consistent would be compatible with string theory. In which case, string theory would make absolutely no predictions whatsoever, and there's absolutely nothing we could do to tell whether or not string theory is correct. Now, the good news is that although the situation is not quite ideal, it's not quite that bleak either. Because more recent progress has suggested that the string landscape, although enormous, is only a very tiny fraction of a much larger collection of possible universes, which seem consistent, but which are incompatible with string theory. And this set of universes is what's known as the swampland. So the swampland is the opposite of the landscape. The landscape are all these possible universes which are compatible with string theory. The landscape are all the ones that are not compatible with string theory. And so we could really draw a map here of what this looks like. Let's call this here the collection of all possible universes. All universes that are mathematically consistent and are described by quantum mechanics and general relativity. Now, within this enormous set of possible universes, most of them are going to reside in the swampland. And they're going to not be compatible with string theory. But within this vast swampland, the idea is that there are some, that there's some islands, or perhaps a chain of islands, which are comprised of universes which are consistent with string theory. And so up here, these little islands form what is known as the landscape inside this much larger sea, which is the swampland. So what would a test of string theory look like in this framework? A test of string theory would amount to answering the question, does our universe lie out here in the swampland, or does it lie in here, in the landscape? Because if we could show that our universe lies out here in the swampland, that would mean that string theory is not the correct theory of our universe, because it would say that our universe is inconsistent, incompatible with string theory. On the other hand, if our universe resides in the landscape, then that means that it could conceivably be described by string theory. And so this is how we would put string theory to the test. Now, this is a very challenging thing to do for a couple of reasons. From an experimental perspective, this is challenging because it's challenging to figure out what exactly are the precise quantities that describe the physics of our universe. In other words, we don't know where exactly in this picture our universe is. We might be here, we might be here, we might be up in here or down here. We don't understand the physics of our own universe well enough to say whether it's in the landscape or the swamp thing. And that's something that an experimentalist works to try to understand. They want to understand what exactly are the physics, the laws of physics in our universe. Now, I, on the other hand, am a theorist, and we have our own set of problems here, which is that just as the experimentalist doesn't know exactly where we are in this picture, we theorists aren't quite sure where exactly this landscape ends and where the swamp land begins. So the picture that we can see isn't like this, it's more like this. The distinction between the landscape and the swamp land is very blurry. And so it's difficult to tell what exactly are the properties of universes which are consistent with string theory versus the universes that are not consistent with string theory. And if we're ever going to come up with some sort of direct experimental check on string theory, we need to be able to answer this question. We need to be able to say, what are the properties that are universally true of universes in the landscape versus what are the properties that are not true of these universes in the landscape? So the way that this has worked out in practice is that people have conjectured a number of criteria, properties that are supposed to be true for all these universes in the landscape. And the most famous of these, arguably, the one that's certainly gotten the most attention in the last few years, is what's known as the weak gravity conjecture. So again, the weak gravity conjecture is a property that is conjectured to be true for any universe that is consistent with string theory. And the conjecture can be stated heuristically as follows. In any consistent universe, any universe that's consistent with string theory, gravity must be the weakest force. So if we think about our own universe, and the four forces that we're aware of, this is true. Gravity is the weakest among them. And you can see this, for instance, if you compare gravity and electromagnetism, you actually experience this on a daily basis. So let's suppose that you have a refrigerator at home, and you have some magnets on your refrigerator. So there are two forces acting on these magnets. Gravity is pulling them down. The gravitational pull of the Earth is pulling the magnets down. But electromagnetism is keeping them on the fridge. And in the end, the reason why your magnet doesn't slide down the refrigerator is because electromagnetism wins. Electromagnetism is much more powerful than gravity. And that's why the magnet stays there. That's why we're not falling through the floor right now. Right? Because there's a gravitational pull of the Earth, which is pulling us downward, but there's also a force that the floor is exerting upward on us, and that's actually an electromagnetic force, which is keeping us from falling through the floor. So in the end, electromagnetism wins. Electromagnetism is much stronger than gravity in our universe. And this is true for the other forces in our universe that we know of as well. Gravity is indeed the weakest among them. So you might ask, well then why is this conjecture going to be useful? How is this going to matter for real world physics? And the answer is that although the weak gravity conjecture is satisfied for the forces that we know about in our universe, the claim of the conjecture is that even for the forces that we don't know about, gravity must be the weakest among them. And in fact, we have very good reason to believe that in the early universe, just after the Big Bang, there were other forces around which are no longer active today. So in other words, we can no longer feel the effects of these forces today. And so the weak gravity conjecture makes claims about the early universe, and it makes claims about what sorts of models of the early universe are allowed. So in particular, there are a number of models that have been around for the last 10 or 15 years or so in my field, which attempt to describe the universe just a split second after the Big Bang. And these are models of what's called axion inflation. So these are, what they are is that they're models of inflation which use things called axions. And I'm not going to describe either of these things in more detail for lack of time, but I can answer questions if people have them. The point, though, is that there are these models of inflation that utilize these objects called axions, which have very nice features. And as a result, they've become very popular over the last 10 to 15 years. But something that I have shown, which is probably my greatest contribution to science so far, and honestly, probably the reason I got this postdoc, is that it turns out that many of these models of axion inflation have in them forces which are weaker than gravity. And that's something that wasn't obvious. It sort of went undetected for about 10 years. But it turns out when you understand these models more precisely, what you realize is that they contain these forces which are weaker than gravity. And that means that they violate the weak gravity convention. So what this means is that if you believe the weak gravity conjecture, then you would conclude that many of these axion inflation models are incompatible with string theory. So the constraints on these models of axion inflation aren't quite where we'd like them to be. You know, what we really like to have is some prediction from string theory that says the world must be like this, which we can go and take and give to our experimentalist friends and tell them, go look for this. We don't quite have that here. But what we do have is at least something which we can hand not to our experimentalist friends, but at least to our model-building phenomenology friends, the people who build models, who try to build models of the real world. And we can say to them, at least, on the basis of the weak gravity conjecture, that these sorts of models are going to be incompatible with string theory. And so they might be better off focusing their efforts elsewhere, at least if they're trying to build models which are consistent with string theory. So again, this isn't quite where we'd like to be, but I am of the opinion, and I think many others are in my field as well, that this is sort of the closest we've gotten to bringing string theory into contact with experiments in a meaningful way. And the goal then, the ultimate goal of my research and really of this whole landscape and swampland program is that we want to get to a point where we can do even better, where we can take some criterion, some property, which is universally true of these universes from string theory, and use it to make some sort of experimental prediction, and therefore bring string theory into contact with real-world physics. Thank you.